Hi everybody, it's Kyle. Today I'm going to be talking to you about my physics textbooks. Specifically, I'm going to be comparing my undergraduate core physics textbooks with my graduate core physics textbooks. Now, when I say core physics, I'm talking about four main subjects. And those four main subjects are classical mechanics, electricity and magnetism, quantum mechanics, and statistical mechanics slash thermodynamics. So those are the four subjects that I'll be covering today, and I'll be showing you some textbooks from each subject. So first off, let's start with undergrad classical mechanics. So when I was an undergrad, our classical mechanics textbook was this one. It's Classical Mechanics by John Taylor. And I really liked this textbook. It's very clear. He starts with kinematics and Newton's laws, but then he starts to introduce to you the idea of calculus of variations, and then, you know, get into the Lagrangian mechanics, and eventually end with Hamiltonian mechanics towards the end. So it's a really nice introduction to those higher topics other than Newtonian mechanics, and I really liked reading it. It's just a good read. He has good examples for you, and I think the problems are kind of fun and challenging. The only thing I have to say is that my experience with the class wasn't the best because I didn't think the lectures in my course were that helpful, but referring to the book a lot, it was very helpful. This book was very helpful. So if you need to ever brush up on classical mechanics or just want to learn about classical mechanics, I highly recommend this book. So at the graduate level, I actually didn't take a classical mechanics class at the graduate level. That's a story for another time. But regardless, I had to take an exam on classical mechanics as a part of a comprehensive examination in these core subjects. So for the graduate level course, they used classical mechanics by Herbert Goldstein. This is like the gold standard for classical mechanics. I believe the first edition of this book came out in about like 1950. So it's been used in physics graduate classes for the past like 60 years. So it's very, you know, it's very just standard. Pretty much everyone has to go through this book. I actually had to study using this book for the exam that I was talking about. So that's why you see all these sticky notes here denoting different sections. It sort of just jumps right into Lagrangian mechanics and then starts using Lagrangian mechanics in different applications before starting to move towards Hamiltonian mechanics and stuff like action angle variables and Poisson brackets, and actually ends up with perturbation theory at the end. And I think it's cool because towards the end you kind of sort of see the connection between like Poisson brackets and the commutators and quantum mechanics. So this is a standard book. It was kind of a dry and terse read, but I don't know what else I was expecting, to be honest. It's really mathematically rigorous, and some of the problems are very hard to do, but overall, you know, it's an okay book, I think, in my opinion, and some people really like it. So, you know, that's all I have to say about classical mechanics. So now let's move on to the subject of electricity and magnetism. Or in this case, I'm talking about the subject of electrodynamics. So this is Introduction to Electrodynamics by David J. Griffiths. And my physics professor at the time said that this physics textbook would be the best textbook I would ever get as an undergrad or a graduate student. And upon review, I think that this book is really good, but at the time, I don't think I had the same kind of sentiments. I felt that I just wasn't really ready mathematically to take on a book of this magnitude. If you actually look through some of the contents here, it starts off with trying to review vector analysis, vector calculus, and, you know, talk about divergence and curl and the theory of vector fields. And then it will start with electrostatics and start moving its way towards magnetostatics and eventually electrodynamics. I have to say that you need to have a really strong mathematical background if you want to start to jump into this book. And by that, I mean, make sure you know your vector calculus really well. Like, if you don't know your vector calculus really well before going into this book, it's going to be a struggle. So make sure you brush up on your vector calculus and also know separation of variables, specifically solving partial differential equations with separation of variables. If you know those two things really, really well, I think you'll be just fine in taking a course with this as your main book. And, you know, as I review on it, this definitely is one of the better physics textbooks I've ever had. So that was not a false statement. So at the graduate level, we used Classical Electrodynamics by John David Jackson. And this book is just legendary in terms of its difficulty. And a lot of physicists that I've heard speak about this book have always had negative things about this book. But, you know, Funny enough, like, even though I took a class using this as our main textbook, I didn't have to do any problems from it. And some people might find that strange, but the professor was kind enough to write up his own problem sets, just problems that he came up with, and he didn't make us do the problems from Jackson, even though some of the problems were inspired from the problems in Jackson. So he kind of made, he just blended his own, you know, personal taste with electrodynamics. And this is a very comprehensive book. It covers a lot of subjects, and the math in this book is really advanced. So within like chapter two, you're already doing like Green's functions, like orthogonal expansions in different coordinate systems. And it is very mathematically intensive. I was lucky enough to take an applied math minor as an undergraduate. And so I was able to see a lot of the mathematics in this book at the undergraduate level. And without that math minor, I don't think I would be able to succeed in a class like this. So really, you gotta make sure your math is really good. Like, that just goes without saying with any physics. You just need to have a good, solid math background. And if you have the requisite math for the physics, then you can just focus solely on the physics, as opposed to trying to do the math and the physics simultaneously. Next subject, we will talk about thermal physics and statistical mechanics. Now, as an undergraduate, I don't have my textbook on me right now, but I have a picture of its cover, so I'll just show you a picture of its cover on my iPad here. So we use this textbook right here. I hope you can see it, but it says Introduction to Thermal Physics by Daniel V. Schroeder. And now, those of you who are doing particle physics, you might know that Schroeder has a book with Michael Peskin of Stanford. It's called Introduction to Quantum Field Theory. So if you're a particle physics or aspiring particle physics student, you will eventually run into a book by Schroeder. But his thermal physics book, I think, is really good overall. It's very clear and concise. He has a lot of good explanations for different phenomena, and he helps you sort of relate the things you learn to the real world. My one biggest gripe with this book, though, is that he has no example problems throughout the text. All the problems are just, you know, normal problems you have to solve on your own without any help from him. And what he'll do sometimes is that he'll make you use the results of earlier problems in the later problems. So you could be doing like problem 415, and then he'll say, refer back to the answer for problem 225 in this problem. And so it means you have to do, you know, problem 225 or whatever. And that was really annoying. But funny enough, when I went through this course, our professor went through every equation in this book. We literally covered the entirety of this book. So the last, like, I think two chapters are on statistical mechanics, and that was my only exposure to it at the undergrad level. So overall, I think it was pretty good. And my one gripe again is just not enough example problems. Now, at the graduate level, we use this textbook here. Let me get it out here. Statistical Mechanics by Pathria and Beal. Now, at the grad level, I've heard of a lot of different choices for statistical mechanics in their courses. I've heard of a book by an author named MacArthur. There's a book by Reif that might also be an undergrad book. I'm not entirely sure. But StatMech by Pathria and Beal, I think, is okay. It's very comprehensive and it's very dense, and I didn't always find the examples to be that helpful, and I didn't really like reading this book. The way it was written, it reads kind of weird for me, but that's just my personal opinion. And, you know, it has a nice appendix in the back on the different, you know, math you need to succeed in statistical mechanics. But again, explanations could be better, in my opinion. But, yeah, so that's pretty much all I have to say about this book. I never really went into it that much. There's only a few sticky notes here spread out through the entire book. So again, I'd say pair it with other statistical mechanics books and you should be okay. And last but not least, I want to talk to you about my favorite core subject, which is quantum mechanics. So at the undergraduate level, I used this textbook. It's Intro to Quantum Mechanics by David J. Griffiths. And this is the second edition. He's coming out with a third edition, or I think it might actually be out already. But this book is kind of polarizing. I've heard really good things about it, and I've heard really bad things about it. And when I first took quantum mechanics, I was in the camp of, like, I really like this book. But now, as I've taken more quantum mechanics classes, as I've gotten older, I kind of am slowly moving away from that point of view. And while I still think this book is good for a first introduction, there are some things that I don't really like what he does. Like, for example, he doesn't really give you motivation to learn about Dirac-Brockett notation. He just shows you the mechanics of it, and which is fine. You know, if you really just want to know about how to use Brockett notation, then okay, you know, this book is fine for that. But if you want more of a deep, you know, abstract understanding of quantum mechanics and, you know, why we're thinking about it in terms of these, you know, linear algebra concepts, then maybe this book isn't the best for that. I will say, though, it does have a nice amount of worked out examples in this book. And the good thing about that is that in quantum mechanics, there's only so many problems that you can solve analytically by hand in a reasonable amount of time. And even by reasonable amount of time, I could say on the order of like hours at sometimes if you're like really stuck. So, you know, if you need a good reference book for some problems to, you know, refresh your memory on how to do quantum mechanics, I'd say this book is pretty good for that. Now at the graduate level, we use two main textbooks. I'll show you the first one here. It is Lectures on Quantum Mechanics by Gordon Baim. And I really didn't like this book at the start. And as I've gone through a course in it, I started to slowly appreciate it more. It's still very terse and dry. I think that was my main complaint. It's very kind of dry and just sometimes just hard to read. But it is very comprehensive. It covers, I think they say in the intro, 3 semesters worth of quantum mechanics. And I believe it. This book has like 20 some chapters. So it is very comprehensive. And this book apparently was made back in like the 60s, so I'm not too actually surprised that it is kind of terse and dry, because it was written a while ago. But my professor who taught with this book really thinks this book is good. So, you know, it's all a matter of personal preference, and it just wasn't my cup of tea at the beginning. But overall, very comprehensive, and if you want to have a good reference book in quantum mechanics, I'd say pick it up. And the second book we used is Modern Quantum Mechanics by Sakurai, which is a classic quantum mechanics book. And by that, I mean, I heard about Sakurai before I even got to grad school. I remember just reading about things, like reading just what people thought about it, kind of like Jackson. But people were more positive about Sakurai than they were about Jackson. And I think Sakurai is really advanced. Like, it already assumes pretty much that you've seen a book like Griffiths before and you've gone through a course like Griffiths before. And Sakurai just sort of just throws you in from the beginning and kind of changes your perspective on how you should actually do quantum mechanics. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. It just shows you that there are different ways to do quantum mechanics than just the Schrodinger equation, which, to be honest, I really didn't know there was any other way to do it other than the Schrodinger equation. So, you know, it really gives you a more mature view of quantum mechanics, but at a very high mathematical level. So again, you need to know, you know, your differential equations. You got to know, you know, how to do, you know, integrals in multiple dimensions. You have to know some group theory. You get to start learning about the path integral formulation in this book. So, you know, very dense, very comprehensive. But if you want to get a really good, mature understanding of quantum mechanics, this is the book for you. So that's all I have to say about my textbooks, but leave a comment in the video and tell me what your favorite physics textbook is, and tell me if you think these videos are entertaining and if you'd like to see more of my textbook videos. All right, so without further ado, I will see you guys later.